Apple has made a lot of chips over the years. And yes, Apple did already make an M7 and M8. Those were motion coprocessors. We won't get into it. But they're making even more, like the C1X for cellular, the N1 for Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, and Thread. And the new iPad Pro got all three, the M5, C1X, and N1. But this is the new M5 MacBook Pro, and it only got one of those three new chips. The M5 MacBook Pro still has Wi-Fi 6E like the last model, no built-in cellular like the last one. They both max out at 32 gigs of unified memory. They have the same display, ports, colors, cameras. Really, the only difference is the M5 chip. That also makes it for an awkward moment because you can get an M5 MacBook Pro or an M4 Pro or M4 Max. Not to mention, we still have a number of other Macs not updated with the M5, like the Mac Mini, the iMac, and the MacBook Air. So does that mean you should jump on the new M5 MacBook Pro? Not necessarily. While the new M5 chip does have significant improvements over the M4, especially in regards to the GPU and AI specific workflows, there's a lot of other things to consider. For some of you, MacBook Air might be a better choice. For others, you might want to wait until the M5 Pro and Max come out. And after using it for the last 5 days, I'm going to try and answer, who is this for? This is my hands-on impression of the M5 MacBook Pro. Step one, let's play spot the differences. On Apple's compare page, I put the M4 and M5 MacBook Pros, both 14-inch, and as you scroll down, after that M4 and M5 chip, one big difference is right here. You can get the new M5 MacBook Pro with up to 4 terabytes of storage, the M4 maxed out at 2 terabytes. And under the compute section, you'll see the new M5 has faster memory bandwidth, and it has neural accelerators on each GPU core. That's pretty much it. Like I mentioned before, the display, the cameras, the ports, everything is exactly the same as the M4 MacBook Pro. Now, why would Apple put the M5 chip in this, but not launch the Pro and Max chips? Well, rumors are that those Pro and Max chips just aren't ready yet. We'll probably see them early 2026. But the bottom line is, why wait? We've seen almost annual refreshes of the iPad lineup, the MacBook lineup, and more. Now, that might induce some analysis paralysis, like maybe you should wait to the next one because it's just a little over a year away. But the nice thing is about all the M chips is that they're super powerful. And for most workflows, any modern M series chip is going to do great. I used my M1 Max Mac Studio until earlier this year, and it never missed a beat. It still performed excellently, which is why if you have some of those more pro workflows, you probably want to wait till the M5 Pro and Max come out. And for some of you, you might want to just consider the MacBook Air, even getting the M4 version, knowing an M5 is probably coming soon. Now, I did a bunch of comparison tests in my M5 iPad Pro review. You will see speed gains in certain workflows, especially ones that use on-device large language models. This was a test using the app Transcriptionist, where you can download a local AI model, and comparing M5 to M4, the M5 is significantly faster. Now remember, if you're just using the ChatGPT app, Claude, or Perplexity app on your MacBook, those requests are going to the cloud, so the chip on your actual computer doesn't have much effect. But if you're doing things like transcribing on device, using apps like DrawThings where you can download large language models locally to your device and they run there, then you will see some significant gains in speed, M4 to M5. But again, those are very specific workflows and most people probably won't notice those speed gains. It's also a little disappointing that even though the iPad Pro got the new N1 chip, which enabled Wi-Fi 7, Bluetooth 6, and has a built-in Thread radio, the brand new M5 MacBook Pro doesn't get any of that. So it still has Wi-Fi 6E like last model, Bluetooth 5.3, and many would still love to see cellular connectivity in a built-in MacBook Pro. Now that Apple makes its own chip, I think that's more of a possibility, but we still don't have it yet. But for a moment, let me compare the base M5 MacBook Pro to my MacBook Air, the one I've been using all year to edit videos and whenever I travel. Now, if you're comparing the pricing right now, MacBook Air starts at $1,000, the M5 MacBook Pro starts at $1,600. $600 difference. The MacBook Air does have more color choices, but only maxes out at 2 terabytes, so if you wanted 4, you'd have to go M5 MacBook Pro. The Pro gets better battery life, but these next few differences are key. The display is much better on the MacBook Pro. You have ProMotion, it goes up to 1,000ths of brightness, even on SDR content. And the speakers on MacBook Pro are so much better. After using the MacBook Air for the past year, I do really appreciate the speaker system in the MacBook Pro lineup. They sound amazing. But if you use headphones or AirPods, it's less of an issue. The MacBook Air also starts at 256 SSD, whereas the Pro starts at 512. But here's the thing. For most workflows, unless you just really love the space black color or need the ports like SD card slot and HDMI, I would go with the MacBook Air for most people. This is an incredible machine, and I've been editing multicam 4K footage on it all year. I took this with me to WWDC, that's where I edited all the footage, and the M4 is still super powerful. Plus, you can't beat the thinness and lightness of the Air. After using this all year and getting the M5 MacBook Pro out of the box, noticeably heavier, thicker, and unless your workflows really call for that Pro power, Air is the way to go. But what if it's going to be your only Mac and you do want that pro power? Now, fortunately, I have a newer M4 Max Mac Studio. That's where I do a lot of my workflows. So my MacBook Air doesn't have to be as beefy. But if you're only going to have one Mac, maybe connected to an external display, should you go with the new M5 because it's new? Honestly, I really think you should wait for the M5 Pro and Max. Or if you absolutely need a computer right now, get the M4 Pro or 4 Max. I used an M3 Pro MacBook Pro for a while, and if you're going to be doing the more intense workflows on the go, I think you really want those Pro or Max chips. And any benefits in AI workflows that the M5 has right now, the M5 Pro and 5 Max are going to have that times even more. So bottom line, I think most people should either go Air or wait for M5 Pro and Max. Oh, and one other side note, this is the nanotexture MacBook Pro, which you can't get nanotexture on a MacBook Air. But like I said in my iPad video, I don't think I would. I actually prefer the glossy finish. You get a richer contrast. And unless you're working outside a lot or you're working all in cafes where glare from the window really bothers you, those are reasons to go nanotexture. But for me, I prefer the glossy, both on my iPad and the MacBook Pro. Plus, with a nanotexture display, Apple suggests you use their polishing cloths, which this comes with the nanotexture MacBook Pro. This is the polishing cloth you get if you just buy it separately. And if you get a nanotexture iPad Pro, you get an even bigger polishing cloth. So there's that. So I think I got it. Who should buy the new M5 MacBook Pro right now? If you really care about having the best display in a laptop, great speakers, and ports like HDMI, which if you connect your laptop to screens or you do presentations, having that built-in HDMI port is a benefit, then the M5 MacBook Pro is for you. Maybe you don't do video editing, not really photography, or you're a hobbyist photographer just taking photos every once in a while and that SD card slot would come in handy. The M5 MacBook Pro is a great one to go with. It's the same amazing display you get on the higher-end Pro and Max laptops. It's the same great speaker system, and it's the fastest baseline M chip you can get right now. Also, a lot of times in enterprise and business, the cheapest Pro-level laptop is what is bought for new employees or bought in bulk, and so updating that to the fastest, newest M5 chip, that's great. And the decision might be easier, like during the summertime next year, as people are going off to college, what is the best college computer? At that point, I imagine we'll have an M5 MacBook Air, an M5 complete MacBook Pro lineup, and then it's really just how much power do you need? For most people, I think the M5 Pro, whenever that comes out, will be a great option. If you're just looking for a standard laptop for web browsing, admin work, and you don't do any kind of video, graphics, or photography, the M5 MacBook Air, whenever that comes out, will be an excellent machine for that. But it seems that we're deep into a new era of Apple that because they're making all their own chips across the lineup, we're just going to see these kind of annual refreshes ongoing. New chips, they get put in all the devices as soon as they're ready, so whenever you're ready to buy a computer, you get the fastest one available. I think that's a great thing overall, and don't let it trip you up thinking you need to wait for the next one, because there'll always be a next one. And any recent M series chip from the 4 to the 5, whatever's available right now, you're still going to get a great performing computer that's going to last a very long time. Now, pie in the sky wish list, we still don't have Face ID on MacBook Pros, I still would love to see built-in cellular, and the N1 chip to bring Wi-Fi 7 and Bluetooth 6 to the MacBook Pro line, that would be nice. And maybe colors? I mean, this is the sky blue MacBook Air, mostly silver and many lights. And if you want to get a MacBook Pro, you get a whopping two choices, space black and silver. I mean, we have an orange iPhone 17 Pro now. Orange laptop? Personally, I would prefer green. That's just me. Oh, and the last major difference I'll mention, the MacBook Pro has a fan. And you'll hear it spin up if you really push it to the limit, like with Final Cut or DaVinci Resolve, and while you're transcribing things. And while that fan may give you a little more performance, I think I actually like my MacBook Air being totally silent all the time, even if it slows down in some really intense workflows. But if you have any questions on the M5 MacBook Pro, let me know down in the comments. Get subscribed and hit that like button. And if you want to see my M5 iPad Pro review with lots of testing, check it out right up here. Or if you want to see my review of the iPhone 17 Pro Max, where I took it outside, played a lot with the camera, the telephoto lens, and more, you can watch that review right up here. Thanks for watching. I'll catch you next time.